I'm reading from the 18th chapter of the Revelation, beginning with verse 1. After these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and the earth was illuminated with his glory. And he cried mightily with a loud voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become a dwelling place of demons, a prison for every foul spirit, and a cage for every unclean and hated bird. For all the nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth have become rich through the abundance of her luxury. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive her plagues. For her sins have reached to heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. It's a very interesting phrase. Her sins have reached to heaven. According to these verses, the Christians in Asia Minor near the end of the first century were undergoing very serious persecution. Satan, of course, was behind all of it, and he found two allies to afflict the people of God. Those are symbolized in the 13th chapter of this book as a beast rising out of the sea, exercising great political power, and a beast coming off the land, symbolizing false religion. The two powers merged in what we might refer to as emperor worship and used false wonders to deceive the people. The saints did not and could not receive the mark of the beast, and in their situation, they needed both hope and instruction. As the visions unfold, John sees the ultimate fall of these two beasts. The persecuting power is symbolized as Babylon the Great, because that had been the great power that led God's people into captivity in Old Testament times. As God brought down that Babylon, he also would bring down this one that at that time was afflicting his new covenant people. Revelation 18 describes the fall of these evil powers and sounds a warning to the people of God of that day not to be caught up in the sins which characterize the citizens of Rome. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not her plagues. It is unfortunate, but it's also very true, that the spirit of the world often infiltrates the lives of God's people. The devil, of course, has made sin very attractive. It sparkles and sizzles, it shimmers and it shines, and it promises real living, but unfortunately, it always delivers nothing but death. We are warned, according to 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 through 17, and 2 Corinthians 6 and verse 17, that we should come out from among the world and be separate. In 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 11, Peter said, Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims to abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. The reason that God would judge the great harlot was that her sins had reached to heaven and God had numbered her iniquities. She, of course, became arrogant and said, I sit a queen and am no widow and shall see no sorrow. But God declared that she would utterly be burned with fire, for strong is the Lord who judgeth her. Verse 8. We do know that in times past God had judged ancient Tyre and brought it down. It at one time was a center of commerce and great immorality. However, her sins reached to heaven, and God said, that's enough. God also judged Nineveh and brought it down. Her sins had reached to heaven as well. We know that God judged ancient Babylon, which thought it was invincible. It also said, there is none else beside me. She also said, I sit as a widow. But only God told her, they shall be as stubble. Why? Because her sins had reached to heaven. The point is simply this. It is possible for men and nations to become so wicked that God will no longer tolerate their existence in this world. He will either wipe them off the face of the earth or create situations that are so horrendous that they no longer are capable to deceive the people of God. Through Daniel, Belshazzar was told, the Most High God rules in the kingdoms of men. I think we've forgotten that tonight. We may think that we are a democratic state, and we may think that we elect our own officials and we're in power as to what happens in this country, but let me tell you for sure that God still rules in the kingdoms of men. God is still in control. He has not vacated his throne, nor will he, and our sins reach to heaven, and God is well aware of what's going on in this particular nation. In the case of Rome, John saw in the visions the kings of the earth, the merchants, and the shipmen all mourning the fall of this vast giant of power and evil. Theirs, however, was not the mourning of patriots. They saw the hope of their gain lost. And in Revelation 18, the passage closes with the silence of the tomb and the bustle of commerce and life still forever. In the first chapter of the book of Romans, the Apostle Paul talks about the despicable state of the Gentile world at that time when he describes the hideous sins that were so much a part of their lifestyle and evidently had found their way into the lives of God's people. The Bible declares that he handed them over. God gave them up, or he handed them over. He withdrew his restraining grace and let them have their own way to suffer the consequences of their sins. The Bible indicates that God gave them up in the lust of their hearts and uncleanness. He gave them up to vile affections. Here the Apostle Paul introduces us to the slimy and sleazy world of homosexuality, where men and women dishonor their bodies among themselves. You can be sure tonight that when a nation forsakes God for idols, there is not so much as the conventions of society to hold them back. They will plunge deeper and deeper into sin. In fact, Paul goes on and he describes in great detail the sins that were prevalent among the people of that day. The sins of pagans had come up before God. The Bible says that he gave them up. In other words, he allowed them to continue in their sin until their sins actually destroyed them. Many people don't understand that. They don't recognize the fact that as sin continues, it grows deeper and worse, more serious, and sooner or later, the very sin that men found such pleasure in will actually destroy them because of its insidious evil. Well, what about America today? And what about our sins? Is it possible that our sins have risen to God? Is it possible, as God looks upon this country that we all love and have enjoyed during our lifetime here, is actually in the process of a downward plunge that will eventually cause us to be destroyed by our own sins? You know, there was a time when we spoke of trends in a society that things were headed in the wrong direction. Today, however, the evidence of such national rot is stamped across the stage of action as we watch sometimes with disbelief. Let me mention just a few of the sins that I believe have come up before God. First of all, our disregard for God's marriage law and the disintegration of the home. We live in a society today that disdains God's marriage law. Pearl Buck wrote several years ago, "No other people have changed as much as we Americans have changed since the end of the Second World War, with the exception of Communist China. Nowhere is this change more apparent than in our new ethics of sex." And that's really true. People look at fornication today as a common occurrence, nothing wrong with it whatsoever. As a result, the foundations of our home are being eaten away, and divorce is reaching epidemic proportions for the most trivial of reasons. We read and hear of such things as communal marriages and homosexual families with children, office wives and suburban couple swap clubs are freely promoted. Some people enter into what they call trial marriage in the garb of sexual freedom, and is often fed to our young people and teenagers that are growing up. Some even declare that the home and marriage will soon be outdated and there'll be no reason for marriage or no reason for the home. The foundations of America are trembling tonight and shake as our homes crumble before the devil's freedom peddlers. The Bible teaches in Hebrews 13 and verse 4 that marriage is honorable in all. Any sexual relationship outside of marriage is sinful and wrong. Doesn't matter when, where, by whom it is committed, it is sinful and it is wrong. And that type of relationship, that type of conduct is of course condemned in the Word of God. I believe marriage vows are still sacred. One man for one woman for life. That was God's original idea. That was his original intention. And that's exactly the way it should be. see, not two men or not two women. God created them. The Bible says in the beginning, male and female created he them. Paul assures us in Romans 1 and verse 26 that there is a natural as well as an unnatural use of the body. For their women, he said, change the natural use into that which is against nature, and likewise also the men. Paul needs to be heard in our world today. People need to listen to what the Apostle Paul said. Go home and read Romans chapter 1. Let it sink into your heart and into your mind, and come to realize just how vividly Paul is portraying the very things that go on in our society today. Such abominations rise before God, will not be tolerated by God. And as a result, we need to give heed to that. I want to say a little bit about the fact that we're living in a world today where murder and lack of respect for human life is evident. We are murdering millions of unborn babies every year, and we act as though, as a nation that thinks little about that. In fact, you're out of step with society if you even raise a voice against such a thing as that. You remember in Romans chapter 1 and verse 31, the Apostle Paul said that there were some there without natural affection. That refers, of course, to those who do not possess the love and attachment that nature teaches all mothers to have for their young. In fact, Barnes feels that Paul must have referenced the practice so common among the heathens of exposing their children or putting them to death. The Canaanites, we know, sacrificed their sons and daughters unto devils and shed innocent blood, even the blood of their sons and daughters whom they sacrificed unto the idols of Canaan. Psalm 106, verse 37 and 38. If God looked down upon the sacrifice of these little children so long ago, he certainly looks down upon the sacrifice of our children today by the hundreds of thousands in the world where abortions, of course, are performed. The practice of murdering small children was also common among the Phoenicians, the Carthaginians, the Chinese, and the Hindus. The Nazi Holocaust began with the elimination of 300,000 Aryan German citizens who were considered defective. Before Hitler finished, however, his Nazi war machine had murdered 6 million Jews, plus another 6 million Gypsies, Poles, and prisoners of war. Unfortunately, we today in America are killing more unborn babies than were killed in the Revolutionary, the Civil, the Korean, and the Vietnam Wars. It's a shame, and our sins are reaching to heaven. I want to say, as I bring my remarks to a close, and if I run over, you give me. There is a moral and spiritual weakness in our country today that I believe threatens our very existence. In America today, almost every area of morality has been subjected to a humanistic approach. And as a result of that, moral judgments are being neutralized, and every form of perversion has become an alternate lifestyle. It's time we backed up. It's time we looked at what's going on around us and how it's influencing our children and our families, and realize that our sins are reaching to heaven. God's aware of what's going on in the church. He's aware of what's going on in the world and in this nation. And we need to recognize the fact that there will come a time, as there always had, as there always has, when God will say, that's enough. No more. Your sins have reached to heaven, and God will call a halt.